Thank you very much for the invitation and for the interest in this kind of work, which involves K-theory, non-commutative geometry. So I have two goals for this talk. So I wanna demonstrate that we are past of the struggle of understanding what these words and how these theories work. And in fact, we are way past that point, and we can now interact very solidly with experimentalists and provide a lot of insight. So then I will start. Of course, what is there are two difficult things over here is to explain how the machinery works, but also explain what the machinery is good for. And in fact, the most difficult part is the second one. What is this machinery good for? And in the past, we use it to address disorder systems, to demonstrate stability against strong disorder. But those were things more or less known from the experiment very much. So we were only explaining things. But these days we turn it around and we use this machinery for discovery and pushing, opening doors in material science. So then I'll start my talk with, in fact, a bunch of metamaterials which were engineered to be topological just by using aperiodicity. And the first one is very simple. It's an array of fidget spinners. They are nice. They have a good moment of inertia. They are coupled through magnets, which are glued at these ends. And sure enough, if you kick one of these spinner, then a wave which carry not momentum but carry angular momentum propagates along this chain. They have it's a very nice system. It has a very large Q factor, which now in the laboratory systems that we have now, it's about 500. And of course, if you just have a periodic array of these guys, you will observe just the usual stuff. But if you, in fact, put these fidget spinners in a pattern, which is generated by this algorithm shown here, using the circle, and for example, I start from the bottom and I project down and I put the first fidget spinner, then I move by a length L naught, and in the same time moving by a theta on the circle, and I project down again, I put the second spinner and so on, and I can also do the same on the left. Then I generate an aperiodic lattice, and if you calculate the resonance spectrum, it looks very much like a Hofstadter butterfly. In fact, here I show frequency, but if I will show frequency squared, this will be almost identical with the Hofstadter butterfly known from electrons in magnetic field. Let me point out that I can start my algorithm not from the bottom of the circle, but I can start from any point on the circle. So this pattern has a degree of freedom incorporated already in it, and that's the phason. So I will call this one the phason. The phason for this pattern lives on this circle, but for other patterns, the phason can live on more complicated manifolds or topological spaces. Over here, I'm showing the integrated density of states, which is the number of eigenvalues below an energy level. So I count the energy levels below the eigenvalues below an energy level, and I divide by the length of the chain, taking a very large length. Then a picture like this emerge. And what I'm showing in this graph is IDS on the vertical axis. Theta is the angle used in the algorithm on the horizontal axis, and energy is in the axis perpendicular to the plane. So IDS for sure remains constant inside the gaps. So if I will look from this to this graph from the side, what I will see here, in fact, is the graph coming vertically out of the paper. So every time when you see such a change in color, it means the energy jumped and the graph is vertical. So in other words, these rapid changes or abrupt changes in color enables me to detect what is the integrated density of states inside these gaps. And as you can see, they are all straight lines over here. In fact, they all have the they all have an equation going like n plus m times theta. And here, no matter how you change the magnets, you can put second nearest neighbor interactions. This graph will always show up. And of course, when you see such a graph, then you know it is connected with the physics of the integer quantum Hall effect. You will find edge states and so on. Here is a design where we generated again topological modes. The challenge, or the challenge here was to generate localized edge modes at an interface in a breathable acoustic system. And sure enough, if we pattern the walls of this tube, then we can generate, then we immediately start seeing again this Hofstadter like spectra. And sure enough, we can generate interface modes, and moreover, we can tune the frequencies of these resonant modes by by modifying the phason. So again, the phason was this parameter which is encoded in the algorithm. Same algorithm was used here to now pattern the height of these acoustic resonators. So there is a little cap here, which can be screwed in or screwed out, so that the height of the resonators can be varied according to such an algorithm. And sure enough, when we vary the theta, which is over this parameter, we reproduce the Hofstadter butterfly, and when we modify the phason, which is this theta, we found the edge modes. Now, this is another experiment of totally different nature. It is just a bilayer of periodic lattices. These are acoustic resonators, and the top and the bottom, they are connected through just a chamber, which it's a thin layer, which is better shown here. Because of this design, then we can push the top. We can push the top part, and we can create a cycle, and this will be an adiabatic cycle. And if this system is topological, then hopefully we can observe topological pumping. And indeed, that's the case. we have, if we put a microphone on this end and only on this end, and the receiver at this end, then we push this side fast, then this receiver picks up this signal when the frequency is tuned in one of these gaps. It's no frequency whatsoever when it's picking. So let me see, this is the, you will see here the sound of the first dynamically pump sound. So it, it looks like this. Let me see. And how this one sounds is something like this. So I'll take one more slide to explain why we succeeded where many other did not. So this was the first demonstration of dynamic pumping without any external assistance. And I already showed you that there is a dynamical a phasing in this pattern, which is just, let me see, it's just this parameter X, which resets all the time when another resonators enter from the left. Here are the edge spectrum. Here is the edge spectrum, and we see the chiral modes. And here is a breakdown of the topological pumping. So the source is on the left. It loads the left edge, which is the green, when it's at this stage. But then if we go on with the pumping cycle, the frequency of the mode moves up. And now because the source and mode are at different frequencies, they decoupled. So once you let it go, the mode very much oscillates by itself. So then as we move further with the pumping cycle, then the mode delocalizes and then appears on the other side. So what is the thing here? The mode oscillates, self-oscillates as it goes from left to right. Therefore, we have to be dissipation. There is no dynamical pumping if you cannot be dissipation. So all these static demonstrations in which, for example, here, this is a static demonstration of the same phenomena, is not a real demonstration of dynamical pumping because it doesn't take in account the dissipation. So in this system, what you'll have to modify the height of these resonators at a fast enough speed so you beat the dissipation per cycle. But this, for example, in this design, you will need a lot of independent actuator and furthermore, they need to be controlled independently. So the system will need another layer of really, really complex engineering. So here, because of the design, we were able, in fact, to modify the phasing really fast and in a periodic fashion. Now note that that's because we gave up on any tuning regarding the connection. The coupling is just through this layer, and we have no control on how these resonators are coupled or any mechanism for fine tuning. But what we know is that if the coupling is large, then these gaps will open, and that's all we needed. Now, of course, what is not explained here is how is this aperiodic pattern connected to the physics of the integer quantum Hall effect, and this you'll see it in the next slides. This is a system of another entirely different nature. It's a lattice of resonators, and they sit on a periodic potential. If the lattice is aligned with the potential, then there is nothing interesting to say. But if we rotate, then we get moiré-like patterns, and sure enough, Hofstadter spectrum show up. Furthermore, when we show the integrated density of states, we see these very particular curves, and no matter how what's the nature of how complex the lattice is, all these lines over here can be fitted with one single equation. In this equation, you'll see these numbers, including a second chair number, and these are topological invariants related with this pattern. This, if you slide, not rotate but slide, then you generate edge modes, and we were able to figure out what is the volt boundary correspondence for this system. So clearly, this aperiodicity is quite interesting and supplies a lot of a very simple mechanism to generate topological gaps without breaking time reversal symmetry. So in the next slide, I will explain how and what one needs to do to understand all these phenomena. A closer look at patterns. So here it's a one-dimensional pattern. So it's points located on the real axis, x0, x1, so on. The pattern is not periodic, but it can still be labeled by the points of the elements of the group Z. And what I want to explain in this slide is that this pattern has a hole and has a phason, and the phason lives on a phason space, but the phason space doesn't have to be a circle, it can be a torus, and in fact it can be quite exotic manifolds. So this is what I want to explain in this slide. If I put x0 on the origin, then I can reproduce the pattern from these distances, d0, d1, d2, so on. And therefore, the pattern, in fact, through these dn's, can be seen as a point in an infinite dimensional cube. Dn are just the coordinates of a point in this cube. Now, if I rigidly shift this pattern so that each point sits once at the origin, then this point inside this cube moves and traces a shape. This can all be, we can all imagine. So I move this x1 on here, the d's will change, therefore the point inside this cube will change and will trace a shape. Now this trace, this shape, together with the action of z, literally, once I put every of this point to the origin, it gives me a dynamical system. And this dynamical system, it's called the whole of the pattern. A pattern is called homogeneous if this dynamical system is topologically ergodic. So we have a very precise definition of what a homogeneous system is. So I learned this, I massaged this but a little bit so it makes more accessible. So via this geometric picture of sigma. I hope I convince everybody that each aperiodic pattern has one sigma attached to it. If the pattern, for example, is periodic, then this sigma is just a point. We already saw the pattern with a circle. In that case, sigma is a circle. Here, for example, I generate a pattern. It's again a one-dimensional pattern for which the hole is in fact, or the phason space is in fact a torus. So what I did, I literally constructed this shape that I just mentioned. I can construct it straight from it. And what I am doing here, I have this shape in this many dimensional space, and I'm projecting this space on different planes. And no matter what planes I project, I can see something that is always consistent with the torus. And this one is indeed a torus. So that's the first thing, what comes out. Aperiodic patterns have a hole. The hole can be engineered. So we are very much in this experimental project, we are engineering the phase on space, and the phase on space augments the physical dimension, and therefore provides a door into the physics in higher dimensions. So now, how about the dynamical matrices or the Hamiltonians defined over such patterns? I will tell you that even if we start from an ugly looking Hamiltonian, which involves for the moment any kind of hoppings and connections between the between different internal degrees of freedom, there is something very important happening, which comes from Galilean invariance. So the hoppings between M and N sites, they must be, of course, a function of the pattern P and only of the pattern P. And if we shift the pattern rigidly like before, this relation holds. Certainly, if we map in the lab these coefficients, this is what we will find. I call this Galilean invariance because this will be not true if our system will sit in a background potential or a background field. So we take away any background field, so we do have Galilean invariance, and this is guaranteed. Well, if that's the case, then in this ugly looking Hamiltonian, I can drop one of the indices over here, and the Hamiltonian or the dynamical matrix takes this extremely particular shape. It is only a combination of the shift operator and one of these diagonal operator. So the conclusion is that all Galilean invariant Hamiltonians belongs to the algebra generated by the shift and diagonal operator of this form, where f is a continuous function. There is a fact that any commutative system's algebra is isomorphic to the algebra of continuous function over some topological space. And sure enough, when you look at these diagonal operators that we had in the previous slide, you see these functions which are always evaluated not on all the patterns, but only on the shifts of the pattern. And therefore, it's not hard to see that, in fact, this algebra, this space, topological space, which appear in this statement, is nothing but the whole of the pattern. So therefore, any Galilean invariance Hamiltonian or dynamical matrix belongs to a very small algebra. It's the algebra generated by U, which is the shift, and algebra of continuous functions over the whole with this commutation relation. This commutation relation precisely comes from by checking what is the commutation relation between S and this TF. So let's compute such an algebra. For this pattern, this is the pattern with a circle, so the pattern is just a circle, and the algorithm is simply the shift of the circle by theta. Now we know that the algebra over this whole, which is just a circle, is generated by a single function. Why? Because every continuous function can be Fourier decomposed, and then you see that it's just the linear combinations of powers of this function. And now if we calculate the commutation relation written here, we'll quickly find that the commutation relation is just of the that of the non-commutative two torus. So every pattern which has the whole topologically equivalent with a circle, you can be convinced that the Hamiltonian belongs to this algebra. So let's see it in action. Of course, I take this Hamiltonian, take these particular couplings, you do get the Hofstadter spectrum. This we've seen already. How about this one? Same Hamiltonian, is the same Hamiltonian, but now evaluate the Hamiltonian on this pattern, then you will see this spectrum. This spectrum is just, again, the Hofstadter spectrum, but it's a deformed version. The whole of this that pattern is, in fact, a pretzel. And the pretzel is nothing but a loop of a little bit longer length. And you can calculate algebra of observables to be, again, non-commutative torus, but with a different, let's say, magnetic flux. So this knowledge we have used in our experiment where to connect these two incommensurate layers of acoustic resonator with the physics of the integer quantum Hall effect. How about this pattern? Can we understand the spectrum of this pattern? And can we understand why this pattern shows topological head state? You have to admit it's quite wild. While it shows a little bit of structure, it's quite wild, and you'll say it's impossible. But guess what? The pattern was again generated with an algorithm on a closed loop. Therefore, the whole of this pattern, so we are, I'm starting from this point, and I am moving this loop by a constant distance, and I am stepping by a theta. So my point, I step by a theta, and then I repeat. I step by a theta and shift it. So it's really the same circle algorithm, but now the circle has been deformed to this shape just to trick you. But this pattern, this pattern, it's really equivalent to the one generated with the circle. And sure enough, when you compute the spectrum, it's again a Hofstadter spectrum. There are Chern numbers associated to all these gaps. There are edge modes. There is no surprise whatsoever about the physics of this one. So I guess I can convince you a little bit that we do gain some knowledge, and the machinery is quite powerful. Now, how about integrated density of states?
One minute.
Why do we see those lines? Once we have an algebra of observables, then we look at the projections and we say two projections are equivalent if they have one, and if they can homotopically or deform one into another. There are three other equivalences that you can put on projections, and it turns out they are all equivalent. Then if we denote by this the classes under this homotopy, it turns out that these classes together with this operation becomes a group. So what's the big picture? Any separable C-star algebra has a countable K-naught group. Since the topological phases can be enumerated, in many cases, this K group have finite generators. Therefore, any projection, so before we were looking at gap, including the gap projections, can be decomposed in terms of these generators. And in this way, these coefficients, integral coefficients, come out, and these coefficients represent all independent numerical invariants associated to a projection P. Furthermore, if you have a trace, then you take the trace is constant over the homotopy classes of P, and you in fact project this K group onto the real axis. These traces in fact gives us the integrated density of states, and this is how we were able to make all those predictions about the integrated density. Okay, so then I think my time is out. Yeah. I do have a slide showing all these prediction for the integrated density of states following precisely from this K-theoretic machinery.